A little over a year ago, my wife Nancy and I moved to Desert Hot Springs from Venice. And it's a little bit different, you know, I mean, a little. It's an extreme from the ocean to the desert. And it's different there. The people there, it's like Pleasantville. You go to the post office and you buy your thing and say, have a nice day. You say, you too. Then you go to the hardware store and you take the initiative. You say, have a nice day. And they say, you too. Everybody knows their part. Back here in L.A., people are really jaded. So this afternoon, we went to pick up some groceries. And the woman at the cash register is just sitting there very sullen, you know, not even looking up. And I figure it's my mission on Earth today to bring her cheer. So I kind of tease her. I say, aren't you gonna say, have a nice day? She says, it's on the fucking receipt. In Desert Hot Springs, you hardly ever see any homeless people. Whereas here in LA and in Santa Monica, they're in abundance. But Verizon has given them all toy cell phones so that they can walk along and talking to them instead of talking to themselves. They can say, yeah, we thought we were going to have lunch today. What's the matter? No. NASDAQ was the same as the Dow Jones. I don't care. Look, a deal is a deal. And so people think they're businessmen, and they just leave them alone. Desert Hot Springs used to have a motto, people, pride, and progress, which I thought was a multiple choice. And but recently they decided to change it. They decided to change it to clearly above the rest, meaning better than the surrounding cities, which get much more commerce than they do. And so they invited me to perform at the annual... I know, I couldn't believe it myself. It was at the annual Chamber of Commerce installation dinner, the theme of which would be that slogan, clearly above the rest. So they decided that it would have a heavenly theme, clearly above the rest. And so they had the waitresses and waiters all dressed up like angels. And they had one angel on the stage, and she was a lovely blonde playing the harp. And she was on a cloud. It was just this thick cotton. And they had blowers of fog and all of these things that you would expect to find in heaven. So they wanted me to perform, but wearing a devil's costume. It's sort of like the FCC requirement of equal time or a cultural exchange. And so I have never played a character before and had a resistance. I mean, I have a hard enough time playing myself, you know, going through life with no script, no director. But finally, it was an offer too absurd to refuse. And so I went to a costume store and got this costume, and it was all in red, except it had a pitch black shirt, and then it had red pants, a red vest, a red jacket, a red cape, a red bow tie, and red horns. And I had a pitchfork. I was putting my costume on in the bathroom of the hotel where this was going to happen, back behind the kitchen. And I finally got everything on, and I look in the mirror, and there's my pitchfork, and there's my red horns, and there's my cape, and I had a tail. And I'm looking in the mirror, and I'm saying, please, God, help me do a good show. So I was due to go on in about 10 minutes, and so I'm pacing in the corridor back and forth, and there were a couple of women standing with their backs to me at the end of the corridor, and as I'm coming near them and ready to turn, I overhear one of them saying, because they had been at a conference all day and were sitting for hour after hour listening to lectures, and one of them was saying to the other, oh, you know, I would sell my soul for a massage. And now, there are moments when you don't have to make a decision. You have an impulse, and you just know that you're going to surrender to it. So I tapped her on the shoulder and said, just sign here. And I'll tell you, the look on her face should be preserved in amber for future generations. It was a great moment, especially since statistics show that 1 out of every 4 Americans believes literally in the devil. As it was time for me to go out, the kitchen staff would have a clatter of pots and pans dropping on the floor and then kick me out of the kitchen, you know, to symbolize being kicked out of heaven. And then somebody handed me the mic and I went on. And I just continued in that mode of being the personification of evil. and people would come to me and sell their souls. And of course, all the town dignitaries were there. And so, you know, like the woman who had just been reelected as president of the Chamber of Commerce, I said, Colleen, you signed the paper, and I kept my word, you got reelected, and there are better things to come. And everybody's laughing, you know, because they didn't know who I was, but they knew who the devil was. And so in that context, I could get away with anything. So the police chief was there, and I did my research, and I learned that he had a couple of kids, and he and his wife both worked late hours, so they had a nanny who spoke Spanish. And so I said to him, Chief, it's all set. You signed with me, and I'm keeping my word. We're getting a green card for your nanny, and we're getting an English tutor for your kids. The mayor of the town was there, and I said, Mayor, now there had been the Silver Sage Project, which was a low-income housing, and there was a lot of objection to that because they thought that poor people would set a poor example for the other citizens there, and so they reneged on the contract, and they were suing for $3 million, and they didn't have that in the Desert Hot Springs budget. So I said to the mayor, okay, I got your signature, everything's going to work out fine. You're just going to have that meth lab over on Main Street there, and you'll get your $3 million within a couple of weeks. I mean, we had never bought a house before, and so it was all kind of strange because they give you a sheaf of papers this thick with small print to sign, and at the end of each one where you sign, it says, I have read this and I understand it. And of course, nobody reads it, and if they could read it, they wouldn't understand it. So it's just a leap of faith. You sign it, you sign it, you sign it, you sign it. In fact, this mortgage guy was African-American, and compared with me, I was in my usual torn clothing and sneakers, and he's wearing a crisp white shirt and a Rolex and very dynamic. And he comes to one question. He says, what race are you? Well, he says, I'll put down Caucasian. I said, wait a minute. I said, isn't that against the law? He says, well, technically, but go with the flow. Flow with the go. But I'm telling you, when you go out that door, I'm going to put down Caucasian. Since then, the city of Desert Hot Springs has gone bankrupt, so they're changing their slogan again. Now it's clearly above the credit limit.